intellectual scholar of modern college philosophy, previously a tutor in philosophy, who recently joined an English lecture. In a letter to his father, Lewis wrote that he was going out of his home to an academic place, but he was grateful for the something of value that he had learned from philosophy. It would be a comfort to me all my life, he wrote to his father, to know that the scientists and the materialists have not the last word, that Darwin and Spencer, undermining ancestral beliefs, stand themselves on a foundation of science. A gigantic assumption and irreconcilable contradiction. Lewis is not yet a Christian, but he already had misgivings about Darwinian evolution. Lewis has made his interest in the topic of evolution throughout the rest of his life. He discussed evolution in his books and essays. He wrote about it in his private letters, and his books and libraries contain more than 1,000 books and pamphlets focused on evolution. Some of them are marked up with extensive underlining and annotations, including his popular call for Darwin's autobiography. While Lewis was interested in evolution, he also understood its cultural dominance, which helped explain his craziness in having publicly discussed his views. He had told the one correspondent that evolution, etc., is the assumed background of all his life. So Lewis defined life to compass the central evolution of life because he feels a repercussion for his public role as a Christian apologist. In his words, many would have been or being moved towards Christianity by that book would be deterred by finding that I was connected with anti-Darwin. So what were Lewis's real views on evolution? Well, Lewis himself addressed at least three different kinds of evolution in his writings. Evolution as pure time and effect, evolution as unguided natural selection acting on random variation, aka Darwinism, and evolution as a social philosophy, as a social Darwinism. Let's start with his view of time and effect. Time and effect is a claim that all animals currently living are descended from one or two original ancestors through a process Darwin calls the fourth with modification. According to this idea, not only humans and apes share an ancestor, but so do humans, clans, and children. It's clear that Lewis believes that countries can accept evolution as common descent without being biased to their effects. And Lewis's view, whether God used common descent to create the first human beings, was irrelevant to the truth of Christianity. Now, whether Lewis himself finally accepted that humans evolved from lower animals is a complicated question. Regardless, it would be wrong to conclude that his acceptance of the possibility of some kind of human evolution placed him in the camp of mainstream evolutionary biology, or even what might be called mainstream theistic evolutionist ideas. And that's because Lewis insists on three significant limitations to evolution as successfully evolutionary explanations of humanity that place him well outside evolutionary forecasts and then that. The first limit was Lewis's insistence on the actual fall of man. In Christian theology, God originally created humans more than innocent. These first humans then freely rejected God's will for them, resulting in a fall of innocence into the sinful condition of the human race as we currently find it. According to the historic Christian teaching, not only human beings, but the entire creation is tainted by man's initial wrongdoing. In fact, it is to reverse the impact of the fall that God became man to save us from our sin. Thus, the fall provides the necessary backstory for human flesh to be God in the flesh. Lewis reported that the theistic evolution model, which is supposed to be historic, fall is incompatible with mainstream evolutionary biology and therefore must be rejected. Let's consider Professor Carl Waterson, who is the co-founder of the theistic evolution group, Carl Logos, with Francis Collins. In his book, Saving Darwin, Waterson has a section entitled, "He is Arguing the Fall," where he essentially argues that if human beings were created through Darwinian evolution, they were never morally good or innocent. Instead, they were sinful from the start because the evolutionary process is based on selfishness. I would note that Francis Collins wrote an enthusiastic foreword to Waterson's book. Lewis, however, was emphatic that any evolutionary theory that denies the real fall is susceptible to assertion. In his words, "I believe that man has fallen from the state of innocent being created. I therefore disbelieve in any theory that contradicts it. Of course, accordingly, Lewis is careful in his book, The Problem of Sin, to preserve the historical flaw as part of their hypothetical account of human evolution. Indeed, in the chapter that the hypothetical account of human evolution occurs, it's actually titled The Fall of Man. And at the end of that chapter, Lewis declares that the thesis of this chapter is simply that man as a species has spoiled himself. Following very political consistency, Lewis emphasized that man, prior to the fall, had unimpeded fellowship with God. He lived in complete harmony with himself and with his surroundings. He exercised complete command over his appetite, and he lived in harmony with the animals. Lewis's description of human life before the fall sounds very much like the traditional view of the Garden of Eden, described by traditional Christian teaching. Lewis had little patience for evolutionists. He asserted for centuries that he asserted that evolution refuted traditional beliefs about man's original paradisal state and subsequent fall. He was equally skeptical of ethics to reinterpret the fall and make it part of evolutionary history. For example, some Christian evolutionists today, and actually even years ago, reinterpreted the fall as a fall upward into greater maturity and responsibility, as a sort advocated by liberal theologians to handle the problem. Consider progressive Christian writer Brian McLaren today, who argues that the fall is just understood not as a fall from a higher state of innocence and goodness, but as a compassionate coming of age story that represents the first stage of a shift as human beings progress from the life of country gatherers to the life of agriculturalists and beyond. McLaren does acknowledge that the offense of man is marked by struggles and sin, but he seems to believe that human wrongdoing is a natural part of God's plan to bring about human maturity. Lewis, to be clear, set methods of 1943 models for anger, critiquing this very metaphysics, arguing that God intended for human beings to progress to self-knowledge and maturity through obedience, not rebellion. 4 years later, in his book, Miracles, in 1947, Lewis ridiculed those who told the story of the fall in Genesis is not literal, and then gone to say, I could by myself, that it was really a fall upwards. This is like saying that because my heart is broke, contains the metaphor, it therefore means I feel very fearful. This mode of interpretation I regard frankly as nonsense, unquote. Lewis not only believes in a literal fall, but also embraces a literal creation, which is another limit he placed on human evolution. And the problem with him, Lewis wrote, that we do not know how many of these unqualities which are available, how long they continue in the paralyzed state. But in the fascinating poem attended by his Oxford colleague, Tony Gardner, he stated that the person from history who was most like to meet in heaven was Adam. And he's quite serious. When the Torah protested, you can't say that, or if there really were historical forms in the name of the first man, he said, it would be a Neanderthal-like, ape-like figure whose conversation he couldn't conceive of finding the least bit interesting. I don't think that that was his problem. I see you have a Darwinian in it. It was a contender of a problem. Lewis treated also to the Adam as someone who wrote his call to correspondence. To one correspondent, he described his novel Philander, but looking at it in supposition, that what happened to Adam and Eve on Earth could happen to another first type of elsewhere. Lewis's final limit on human evolution was his insistence that the most important things about human beings could not be explained by God's unguided process. In Lewis's view, Darwinian evolution might possibly explain man's physical form, but it cannot explain his mind, his morality, or his eternal soul. That's because the driving force of modern Darwinism is supposed to be the mindless mechanism of natural selection, and Lewis is deeply skeptical about what the mindless mechanism could actually achieve. Which brings us to Lewis's doubts about the creative power of natural selection. Lewis knew that the really momentous feature of modern evolutionary theory is not its proposal that life has a long history, nor even explained that humans and apes share a common ancestry. The truly radical part of modern evolutionary theory towards Darwin is its insistence that life is a product of an undirected process. This claim is not just a product of the seed of an population of industrial atheist-like liberalism. Instead, it forms the very core of orthodox Darwinian theory from the time of Darwin. Orthodox Darwinian theory claims that the primary driver of evolution is the unguided process of natural selection, which is sometimes called survival theory, operating on random variations in nature, random mutations according to its modern evolution. This process acts without plan and without forces, other than to preserve space for immediate survival. Darwin himself repeatedly clear that evolution by natural selection neither required nor involved intelligent life. Indeed, according to Darwin, this theory of natural selection provided a definitive representation of the claim that the features of the natural world reflected a piece of view design. As he put it, quote, the old argument of divine nature formerly seemed to be so confusing, failing. Now that the law of natural selection has been discovered, and we need natural selection as its final substitute. The dominant view of evolution today in the scientific community remains essentially Darwinian, even though the Darwinian evolution. But it is a claim that it is simply another form of undoubted evolution even today. In the words of 38 Nobel laureates who issued a statement defending Darwin's theory several years ago, evolution, as they understood it, is the result of an undoubted, unplanned process of random variation in natural selection. According to Cornell University School of Agricultural Sciences in the field of evolutionary biology, 90% reject the idea that evolution is directed to a sensory pattern of ultimate purpose. 90% of the evolutionary scientists reject the idea of evolution. Now, one certainly can perceive that a theory of guided evolution, but mainstream Darwinian theory is not it. Darwinian evolution, by definition, is an unguided process that brings order and disorder to a combination of chance and necessity. But chance as a fundamentally mind-versus undirected process takes exquisite form and function seen throughout the natural world. Lewis didn't think so. Lewis did affirm that, with Darwinism as a theory in biology, I do not think that this can have any force. But for Lewis, what he called Darwinism as a theorem in biology was a pretty modest attempt. Contrary to leading evolutionists, Lewis said that, quote, "Surely the purely biological theorem of evolution makes no cosmic statement, no metaphysical statement, no epistemological statement, nor can it even explain any of the most important aspects of biology." According to Lewis, it does not in itself explain the origin of organic life, nor of the variation, nor does it discuss the origin and validity of reason. So what can the Darwinian mechanism explain according to Lewis? Granted that we now have bodies, granted that we have bodies, we can trust those bodies, granted that we can trust those bodies, granted that organic life can be exist, then Darwinian theory tries to explain, say, how a species that once had wings came to lose them. It explains this by demanding the fact that the environment operated in small variations. In other words, according to Lewis, Darwin's theory explains how species can change over time by losing possible species that have been lost. Suffice to say, this is not all that the Darwinian mechanism is supposed to explain, or even the most important thing that Darwin thought he was explaining. Noticeably, Alex's and Lewis's description of the biological theory of evolution, which is a step, is the formation of fundamentally new forms and features in biology. Natural selection did not have a limit to pass the other way in the first place. Lewis provided clear indication that he thought it could. The ultimate challenge to Darwinian mechanism, though, in Lewis's view, was man himself. How does such a blind material process produce man's unique capabilities of reason and thinking? Lewis, of course, is far from the first to direct what he does by Darwinism's ability to explain man. Dr. Russell Wallace, the co-founder of Darwin, the modern theory of evolution itself, raised the same doubt. As did Mr. Roman Catholic law, the St. George Jackson Marvel, who set down that the genesis of species gave Darwin sex. Darwin was so concerned about the naysayers that he responded in 1871 with two volumes and nearly 900 pages of prose, which in his treatise, The Descent of Man, it forcefully argues that unguided self-reflection could produce man's mental and moral faculties perfectly well, thank you. Lewis thought otherwise, and he was tutored in the text by a little known volume titled Deism and Humanism. This is a 1916 by Sir Arthur Alford. Alford is probably best remembered today as the British Prime Minister who issued the Balfour Declaration, calling for the establishment of a homeland for Jews in the original homeland in the Middle East, in British Palestine and in the Israel. In Deism and Humanism, Alford argued that any effort to explain the human mind in terms of blind material causes is self-refuting. He offered a similar critique of materialistic accounts of human morality. Alford's basic argument for long display in Lewis's 1947 book, Miracles, as Paul Ford points out, that Jesus used the language of Alford clearly the first five chapters of Lewis's book, Miracles. The revised 1960 edition of Miracles is generally recognized as having more of a material critique. A facility of naturalism or materialism to account for man's rational faculties. But far less notice is the challenge Lewis's book raises for Darwinian evolution in particular. Because the specific example of naturalism Lewis has talked at length in Miracles is Darwinian natural selection, not just plain vanilla naturalism. In the words of Lewis, naturalists argue that the type of mental behavior we now call rational thinking or inference must have been evolved by natural selection, by the gradual weeding out of types less fitted to survive. Lewis flatly denies that such a Darwinian process could ever have produced human rationality. Natural selection could improve our responses to stimuli in the standpoint of physical survival without ever turning them into reasoned responses. Following Balfour, Lewis argues that attributing the development of human reason to a non-rational process like natural selection ends up undermining our confidence in the reason itself. After all, if reason is merely an unintended byproduct of a fundamentally non-rational process, what grounds do we have left for regarding its conclusions as objectively true? Lewis knew that the corrosive impact of Darwinian talk of mind was not merely theoretical. In his personal copy of Darwin's autobiography, Lewis highlighted two passages where Darwin himself questioned whether the conclusions of the mind produced by Darwinian process could be trusted. In both passages, Darwin vividly justifies his embrace of agnosticism because evolution has destroyed its confidence in the human mind. In Darwin's words, can the mind of man, for example, that fully believes and develops from a mind that knows that possessed by the lowest animal, be trusted when it draws such grand conclusions? There is a response in Miracles to this kind of attempt into irrationality, which is quite out that the theist need not suffer such paralyzing doubts. What? Because in the theistic worldview, the preliminary processes which nature led up to the human mind, if there were such preliminary processes, would have been designed to do so. In short, if an evolutionary process did produce the human mind according to Lewis, it could have been Darwinian evolution, but evolution directed by intelligent design. Just as Lewis rejected Darwinian explanations of the human mind for undermining the validity of reason, he rejected Darwinian accounts of morality because they undermine the authority of morality. According to Lewis, by attributing our moral beliefs and practices completely to mindless and non-moral causes, Darwinists undermine the belief that moral standards are something objective or true, or even the belief that some moral beliefs are objectively preferable over others. After all, if all human behaviors and beliefs are merely a product of natural selection, then cruelty has the exact same basis in biology as kindness. Rape has the same basis as chivalry. Infanticide has the same biological basis as self-sacrifice. According to Lewis, the person who offers written account of morality should honestly admit that there is no such thing as wrong and right, no moral judgment can be true or correct, and consequently, no one system of morality can be better or worse than another. Lewis's willing to choose the natural selection shows why it would be so misleading to classify him as a theistic evolutionist, at least how that tends to be used today. experience of evolution can mean anything, is given a form of guided evolution, but many contemporary proponents of theistic evolution say are more accurately described as theistic biologists. That is, they do not advocate a guided form of common defense. Instead, they are attempting to combine evolution as an unguided Darwinian process with Christian theism. Although they believe in God, they generously want to avoid stating that God actually guided biological development. For example, the late Anglican John Fulkingham wrote that an evolutionary universe is theologically understood as a force that allows to make the effect. That really isn't just Christian, biblical, or Christian understanding. Or what's going forward, the former Vatican astronomer at the late first point, and that evolution is unguided, not even God could know with certainty that human life has come to be. Or Christian biologist Ken Miller at Brown University, author of a book called Finding God in God, who insists that mankind's appearance on this planet is not here and there. We are here as an afterthought. A man of the a common sense in the history that life just as well as left us out. These are all Christians here, again. We're also familiar with these attempts in his own day by some Christians to imbue undirected evolution with some sort of propensiveness overall, because it's sort of vague and dark overall, creator, even though he doesn't die and doesn't know how things are going to turn out. Lewis is familiar with one of the similar types of arguments of, again, denying, giving evidence of some sort of purposefulness while still denying the operator for the guiding authority. Lewis says he was not persuaded. And his book, Interestingly, in a passage that was too little, really forgotten, or too much forgotten, and for plausibility. Lewis, by death, is proposed third way between Orthodox Darwinism and the writer called Intelligent Design. He wrote, people who hold this view say that the small variations by which life on this planet evolved from the lowest forms of man were not due to chance, but to the driving or propulsiveness of our life force. When people say that we must ask another by life force to mean something with the mind, if they do, then a mind bringing life into existence and leading it to perfection is really a thought. And their views are identical with the religious views. If they do not, then what is the sense in saying that something is out of mind, strong, or has purpose? This seems to be fatal to their views. Lewis is addressing what today might be called emergent evolution. It shows that while this way of thinking is ultimately so far needs to be the idea of intelligent standards. Lewis knew that ultimately there is no good way, no halfway house, no magical idea. Biological development is either the result of an unintelligent process or a process guided by a mind. And so it is intelligent science. That being the case, Lewis thought that a mind driven process is a far more plausible option than a mindless one. In the book, The Magician of Ten, I've written a four positive argument that Lewis made for the intelligent side of nature, attaining Lewis, beauty, morality, reason, and really the functional complexity that we see in living things, all point toward a transcendent and intelligent path outside of nature. You can read Lewis's reason, but sometimes in Europe, you get more of that. This afternoon, however, in the rest of my time, I'd like to focus briefly on three objections to intelligent design that Lewis effectively answers. The first objection is that intelligent design is unnecessary because we now know that complex biological features habitually emerge from simple things through unguided natural processes. Even some Christians are taken in by this objection. Consider biologist Walter Alcagate, who was for many years with our staff with the Biological Foundation, the Postmodern Evolution. Alcagate claims that amazingly complicated molecular machines, such as this bacteria exosome, which functions as a high-tech inboard motor, magically self-assemble without any guiding intelligence. As Dr. Alcagate writes, it's tempting to think that the spontaneous formation of so complex machine is guided, whether by a mind or some life force, but we know that the bacterial flagellum, like countless other machines in the cell, assembles and functions automatically, according to our natural law, no intelligence required. Unquote. I wonder whether Dr. Applegate draws the same conclusion every time he opens an Excel spreadsheet and discovers that it magically adds and subtracts from no intelligence required. Or when the word processing program magically sets the banner and spelling of the blog post. No intelligence required. But one further wonder is whether Dr. Applegate has ever visited a modern assembly line where robotic equipment magically assembled any number of amazing products. No intelligence required. Of course, intelligence is required for each of these actions. The intelligence simply happens to be a program to align the human beings into the computer operation and assembly instruction. Similarly, the so-called magical assembly of a bacterial cell requires massive amounts of genetic information, and as my colleague Michael Beebe and Stephen Moore have successfully told you, that sort of information ultimately requires an intelligence cost. Little spot of the fantasy may be a reason advocated by Dr. Applegate and some of her colleagues at High Waldo, how it seems to be a pure hallucination of the case. Why did it say that? Because Lewis pointed out that in the real world, we have never actually seen a pile of rubble turning itself into a house. Instead, what we actually observe in nature are complex living things habitually arising out of equally complex living things, and simply things that turn into complex things being conceded at a very complex point that they grow into. Those that happen in the chickens ultimately arise not from time differentiated clutter problems, but from fully developed chickens in their eggs. Molecular material that still arise not from simpler parts, but from earlier bacteria that already have those same molecular machines. As a result, the ordinary physical processes of nature that we observe do not explain the actual origin of the complex structural features we find in nature. Even less can it explain away the nuclear intelligence cause for those features. As Lewis wrote, on any view, the first beginning must have been outside the ordinary process of nature. From my own experience of the creation of machines and human artifacts, the natural candidate for that outside cause is an intelligence bias. A variation on objection one is dependent on natural laws, which is a highly complex biology that we can develop in nature as far as it depends. Dr. Applegate alluded to this idea with the claim that the bacterial flagellum is quite capable of adding material to the cell and some of the functions automatically according to known natural laws. And that this method is quite no intelligence required. And again, according to Lewis, he pointed out that the laws of nature are absolutely incapable of causing anything on their own, as he wrote. The laws of motion do not set slowly balls moving. They analyze the motion after something else, say a man with a cue, or a look, a belonging, or perhaps supernatural cause. That's what I would say. The laws of nature require input from the outside, and if the effect cause of your own belief is wrong, then a look, a belonging, the input will need to come from an intelligent source. As we said, a man with a cue, supernatural cause. Okay. Final objection, intelligent design simply objected to today antitrust simply because intelligent design components disagree with two parts of Schrodinger's theory. His Schrodinger theory that we can sense the real planet, although that's challenging, but they can sense the real planet, challenging it must make one antitrust theory easy. The ridiculousness of this argument is readily apparent if one follows the logic to its conclusion. Darwin himself would have been declared on the high planet, the challenging of scientific consensus that he learned it. There was Galileo. There was Einstein. In his final book, Lewis provided an antidote to this kind of complaint by pointing out that the prize of any given era may be driven more by larger cultural attitudes than the weight of the other. We were called by a keen appreciation for the radical changeability of science. Thus, in his view, science of the police cannot be regarded as sacrosanct, and it's not often enabled in terms of any other idea, anti-science merely because it challenges an existing consensus. Now, Lewis was a literary scholar, not a scientist, and he didn't feel it was his place to saying different scientific attitude to keep up with the science of their day, because he said, we have to answer the current scientific attitude towards Christianity. And he further encouraged Christians to write books about science that would counter this from a terrorist worldview by presenting what he called perfectly honest books. Most important book. Lewis was a consistent champion of following the argument and following others wherever it might be, without placing other people's barriers to consideration of your ideas. I think many people don't realize just how much Lewis modeled this principle in his own life, or how he encouraged his students to adopt the pseudo of their own. A good example is his role in founding the climate club at Oxford University. From 1942 until he left the Cambridge University in 1954, Lewis served as the president of the club, as the Climate Club, a weekly gathering of students and scholars devoted to living out the injunction of Socrates to follow the argument wherever it led them. The question in debating the truth is philosophy of Christianity. The answer to the Climate Club likely had a profound influence on many students. But no one thought that on one attendee, he later recalled that the Socratic principle I thought exemplifies it. Of all the evidence, whatever it may be, increasingly became a guiding principle in development requirements and sometimes reversal of my own philosophical views. The attendee in question was a young man named Matthew Stewart, who went on to play an important role in legitimizing the contemporary debate over intelligent design issues, eventually becoming one of the noted academic atheist philosophers. Who startled the world in 2004 by publishing an announcement of atheism in favor of the belief in God, although sadly not in Christianity. Following the pseudo he has seen embodied by Lewis and Socratic Club, Stewart has continued to follow the evidence compared by him to himself, who credited new scientific evidence during Paul's trial as a key reason for his abandonment of atheism. As he told one interviewer in 2004, I think the argument we have by is enormously stronger than the argument for a thought when I first met him. Through his reading and having written books by Paul's advisor, Michael Greenley, and William Benson. And he was especially influenced by the argument for Brian based on the biological information encoded in DNA. But in the end, I have to think Lewis' greatest contribution to contemporary debate over Darwin and intelligent science may have been his confidence in Christians, the truth, and the truth of others. I think he could pursue an argument wherever it may lead. They could be afraid of the argument. Darwin's history inspired me to consider seriously new evidence for intelligent science despite the prejudices of the existing intellectual establishment, and the evidence came to their mind. Just like it continued to change my attitude.